So today I'm talking to Dr. James W. Pennebaker. He is professor of psychology at the University of Texas at Austin and the executive director of Project 2021, aimed at rethinking undergraduate education at that university. His cross-disciplinary research is related to linguistics, clinical and cognitive psychology, communications, medicine, and computer science. He and his students have explored natural language use, group dynamics, and personality in educational and other real-world settings. He has demonstrated that physical health and work performance can be improved by simple writing or talking exercises. Dr. Pennebaker has received numerous awards and honors, has written or edited more than 250 scientific articles, as well as 9 books, including, more recently, Expressive Writing, Words That Heal, and The Secret Life of Pronouns. He also happens to be one of my favorite psychologists. Welcome, Dr. Pennebaker. I'm very much looking forward to talking to you.
Well, it's nice to be here. Thank you.
Great. So, as you may know, because I think we've talked about this a little bit before, I developed some online computerized writing programs with my colleagues, one of which we call Future Authoring, one's Past Authoring, one's Present Authoring. They're a suite of writing programs, and they were heavily influenced in their design by your research. My lab's been interested in narrative for a long time, and also in clinical work, and also in the application of psychology in the real world setting, in the practical setting. And I spent a lot of time developing tests to help employers screen for employees, and we got pretty good at that. But while I was doing that, I was constantly bombarded with questions from managers, of middle managers, usually of medium-sized and large corporations, telling me that it was all well and good if they could hire better employees, but they wanted to know what they could do with their poorer performing employees, because that was a continual and intractable problem. And I thought, well, you don't have that much interaction with them, and it's not that easy to solve people's problems, so there's probably not a lot you could do. But I kind of got sick of telling people that over and over, and so I scoured the literature, and it was at that point, probably about 10, 15 years ago, that I came across your research on expressive writing. So maybe you could start by telling us what you learned and how you went about it.
Okay. A little bit of background. I'm a social psychologist by training, so I don't have any clinical training. Most of my career has just been stumbling upon one idea after another, as opposed to approaching anything with a clear set of where I was going. I had been looking at mind-body issues. I've always been interested in how psychological factors influence physical health and mental health. And I came across a finding years ago that just bugged me, and that was people who have had a major traumatic experience in their lives that were much more likely to get sick than people who had not. Now, that was an old finding. But as I dug in more deeply, what I discovered was people who had a trauma and kept it secret were far more likely to have health problems than people who had the same trauma but who talked with others about it. And it made me wonder, what if we brought people in the lab and had them actually write about it, some kind of trauma, ideally one they hadn't talked to other people about, would that influence their health? And that was really the underlying idea. So the very first study was done in 1983, and we brought in about 50 people. Some of them were asked to write about the most traumatic experience of their lives. The other half were asked to write about superficial topics. I'm simplifying the study some. And they wrote for 4 days, 15 minutes a day. And they also gave us permission to track their student health center records. These were college students. And this was at a private college where the student health center was right next to the dorms. Well, what we discovered was that those people who were asked to write about traumatic experiences ended up going to the student health center at about half the rate as people in our control condition, the ones who had written about superficial topics, over the next 3 to 6 months. And this was a really stunning finding. It was, you know, what I kind of hoped would occur, but I was so thrilled that it actually worked. And then we did another study that was very similar. And here again, we had half the people write about traumas, half write about superficial topics, and they just they wrote about trauma or superficial topics, by a flip of the coin, we decided which of the two topics they'd write about. And this time we drew blood before we assigned them to condition, again after the last day of writing, and then 6 weeks later. And the blood was assayed by a group of people at Ohio State looking at immune function. And again, we found that writing about traumatic experience was associated with enhanced immune function and also reductions in doctor visits. And this now was takes us to about 1988, and by then other labs started to see what we were doing, and the whole technique started to take off. And then over the years, more and more labs, including my own, found generally positive effects, not always, but generally, that writing about upsetting experiences had this salutary effect that influenced both health, physical health, and markers of mental health. And then later, various labs found it to be related to all sorts of things associated with increased memory, cognitive functioning, and so forth.
So if I remember correctly as well, when you were doing the earliest studies, you were also influenced by Freud's idea that of catharsis, and that was the idea that if people had a traumatic or unpleasant experience, if they were encouraged to express the emotions that were associated with that experience, that would be curative. That was partly Freud's hypothesis. But you
it is absolutely consistent with Freud's initial idea. And what was interesting is, because most people listening to this podcast will hear catharsis and they will think that catharsis means blowing off steam,
right,
or venting. And that's not actually what Freud actually meant. And it's interesting, in Europe, catharsis has a completely different meaning than it does in North America. So in North America, we view it as venting. Freud and Europeans view catharsis as connecting emotions and thoughts. And that is actually what I was doing. I had assumed that Freud meant venting. And we had found actually that people who just blew off steam, who just expressed emotions, actually didn't show any health improvements.
Right, you did a linguistic analysis, right? And that was one of the things that was really fascinating about the research. So maybe you could tell us a bit about that too.
Well, I wasn't initially, I had never been interested in psychotherapy, and here all of a sudden I was doing a study that was essentially glorified psychotherapy, which got me speaking to clinicians. And then the question was, why does writing about an upsetting experience bring about these changes? And it's a straightforward question, but there's not a straightforward answer. And my lab and others started looking at all sorts of possibilities and looking at markers of inhibition, you know, that people holding back were more prone to illness, and what this did was to loosen them up. We didn't find good evidence for that. Other people had other hypotheses. And at some point I started looking at what people were actually saying. And I got groups of people, students who were in clinical psychology, to rate the essays that people wrote and on all these different dimensions. And what I found was that relying on people to read these essays and come up with some kind of deep understanding or even predicting if a person would benefit or not just didn't work. It was too hard. The stories were really traumatic. They actually depressed a lot of the people who were who were reading the essays. So it occurred to me it would make much more sense to come up with some objective marker of reading these essays, and a computer program would be what I needed. Well, it turns out back then, this was now the early 90s, there was no such program. And fortunately, I had taken a little computer science in college, and one of my graduate students, Martha Francis, had actually done her undergraduate degree in computer science. And so I asked Martha to essentially help me do a computer program that could go through and analyze the language of an essay. And the idea behind it is really quite simple. You have the computer go in and look at each word, and you would compare each word in the essay with some master list of words. So let's say we're looking for anger words. We want the computer to count up all the words associated with anger. So we'd have this dictionary of anger words. And to get that dictionary, we had to make that ourselves. We had to look in dictionaries, the sources. We had to have students generate anger words. And then we had all these rules of what makes for an anger word versus not. But once you have that list, you go through and you have the computer look at each word, compare it with the master list. And anytime it finds an anger word, it just adds it up. And at the end, it adds up all the anger words, divides by the total number of words, and it produces the percentage of total anger words in the essay. And we did this now for not just anger words or sad words, guilt words, negative emotion words in general, but we did positive emotion words and then cognitive words, words that suggested cause and effect, like cause, because, effect, rationale, words such as that. And then as long as we were doing it, we added more and more dimensions. We, you know, we had pronouns and prepositions and articles, et cetera, et cetera. We ended up with about, now there's probably 80 different dimensions. But when we went back and started looking at essays, we found that certain dimensions of writing really predicted health improvements. Now, we found that use of positive emotions was associated with health improvement. So if you can write an essay about the worst thing in your life and still use positive emotions, it's a marker that you're going to show health improvements. The effects are pretty small. Negative emotion words, using a moderate number of negative emotions is weakly related to doing better as well. But what turned out to be far stronger was use of cognitive words, words like because, cause, effect, words like understand, realize, know. These are words that we now know are markers of people working through a problem.
So let me ask you a question about that, because I've thought a lot about that. I thought that was really an interesting idea. So this question has to do with the function of memory. Mm-hmm. So it's pretty obvious that we don't and can't store what's the equivalent of a videotape of the entire domain of sensory experience when we're interacting with people. And it is obvious as well that that isn't how memory works and that memory is modifiable across time. And so here's a hypothesis for you, and tell me what you think about this. It seems to me that the purpose of memory is so that you can remember the good things that happened to you in the past and how they occurred and duplicate them in the future, and remember the bad things that happened and figure out why and change your course of life and your pathway in the future so that they occur less frequently. And so the cause and effect analysis would be something like the adjustment of a pathway map. And mm-hmm. It sort of reminds me of the work that was done with rat memory, because the hippocampus seems to store something like cognitive maps. And, mm-hmm. and maps, almost by definition, are representations of ways to get from one place to another. And so you could think maybe that you go from one place to another and you fall into a hole, and that's very traumatic. And so you remember the pathway and how you got there, analyze it, and reconstruct a different potential future causal pathway so that you don't have to fall in the same hole twice. Now, I don't know what you think about that, but...
I think that works is true, both the way you describe it, but also on a much broader metaphorical level. So, for example, a person who falls into an emotional hole, that their life is going well, and then their girlfriend dumps them, and they go and get drunk in a bar and wreck their car. That experience is incredibly, incredibly complex. And it, unlike the rat, what the human mind has to figure out, what in the world went on with my girlfriend? Why did she leave me? What did I do? Why did I go get drunk? Have I been drinking too much? And
right.
If to process that requires tremendous cognitive capacity. And what happens is, if it's something we're humiliated about, we're really reticent to talk to other people about it.
Yeah.
And language is a really efficient way to process complex issues.
Yeah,
and
especially shared language, you know.
That's right.
Well, so what I found in my clinical practice very frequently is that I think with people who are traumatized, they often encounter, this is something else I wanted to ask you about, they often have an encounter with malevolence as well as an encounter with just catastrophe. So it's not only that something bad happens to them, it's often something bad that's been consciously directed at them by another person. And they have a really hard time mapping that, especially if they're somewhat naive people. But then the other people who are detrimentally affected by such things and can't recover are those who have no one to listen to them. Because people, it seems to me that most people think by talking. And unless you have someone to talk to, you actually don't get to think through it and draw the appropriate, let's call them causal lessons. So, and then you also made this comment about, you know, let's say the classic example I like to use is that, you know, maybe you're a pre-med student and you write the medical, the G, what is it? What's the one for medical entrance?
MCAT.
Yeah. So, you know, you construe yourself as a pretty solid student. And that's a core element of your, of, like it's a predicate of the multiple maps of your life that you use. And then you write the MCAT and you end up with 20th percentile scores. And so then what happens is that not only is your map of the future now rendered null and void, but so is your map of you as a predicate for present actions. And also everything about yourself that you thought held true in the past has to be reexamined. And so it's something like the degree of trauma is proportionate to the amount of the area that of map that's disturbed by the unfortunate, unexpected, and sometimes malevolent event. And so then the other thing I was thinking about with regards to this, and I think this is more germane to the immunological element, is so it's obviously very, very difficult for the mind to compute how dangerous the environment is, because the environment in some sense is infinitely dangerous, and you never know when something small happens to you if it's the harbinger of something that's terrible. So because an ache in your side can be the cancer that kills you. So you might ask yourself, given the complexity of framing in an unexpected event, how do you ever manage it? And so part of it's temperamental. So if you're higher in neuroticism, things hit you harder. And part of it is based on your observed competence. But the other part, I think, is something like, it's something like the brain computes the proportion of times that you failed in the past compared to the times that you've succeeded, and calculates like a mean danger index. And then it raises up your average cortisol levels in correspondence to how dangerous the general environment has been, because that puts you on alert more. And the problem with the advantage to being on alert is that, well, if anything else negative happens, you're more ready to act. But the negative consequences is that cortisol is toxic in high doses across time. And it also suppresses immunological function. And it also tends to suppress prefrontal functioning as well, because the prefrontal cortex is more involved in medium to long-term planning and less in short-term, like emergency preparation activities. So I'd also like to know if, you know, do those ideas ring a bell? Do they seem?
So they do. There's another dimension that ties into this, and that is sleep. So we know that sleep is intimately related to cortisol, it's related to depression, it's related to immune function, it's related to, you know, all of these systems are intercorrelated. And the person who is dealing with an upheaval that they're trying to understand, but they don't have somebody to talk to, end up not sleeping as well. And part of it is they're trying to process all this additional information. And this ties into the idea of working memory, that they have less working memory. They're not sleeping as well. Cortisol is higher there. And they are also worse friends. So when you talk to them, they're distracted, they're not paying attention. And so all of these things are working together to undermine the person. Now, the cortisol hypothesis is a wonderful hypothesis. The killer problem is that the studies that have been done with cortisol and its link to writing and trauma have been, you'd have to stand back and look at the overall studies and kind of squint, and there's a weak evidence to support it, but it's not as clean as I wish it were. Of course, this has been the problem with the writing research, but it's also the problem of all clinical research, that there is, you know, once you start getting real data, and this is not just self-reports of a client saying, oh yeah, that was really great. When you start to get objective, hard data, everything is kind of off the table, that the effect sizes are very, very modest. Mm-hmm. And by the way, that's true of medical outcomes as well, for medical disease.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So, okay, so, well, the downward spiral that you sort of described there too could also account for the negative health consequences post-trauma. I mean, so you can imagine
exactly.
A couple of things. First of all, is that the traumatized person is going to be more reactive to additional trauma, but also that as the effects of their failure cascade, say, across their friendship, interfere with their educational function, interfere with their sleep, the quality of their life overall is going to decline, and that should also produce multiple small stressors that are going to compromise them, including, say, the decreased sleep, and maybe also alterations in appetite, and those might accumulate across time and produce the negative health consequences as well.
Yeah, so, and don't forget that they'll smoke more, drink more, take more drugs, stop exercising. Yes, kids out there, when you have a trauma, take care of yourself.
Right. Right, right. Yes, yes. Well, yeah. Well, I mean, the first thing I do with my clinical clients, generally speaking, is make sure that they're getting enough sleep.
Yeah.
And, you know, try to re-regulate their sleeping, and also to make sure they eat breakfast at least, because that without those two things, it's very difficult for someone to get themselves back on the straight and narrow. So, So now, when we designed the self-authoring program, I think it was research by Laura King. Mm-hmm. But I don't remember. Somebody had taken your writing exercises and applied them to the future, had people write about the future instead of the past, and found similar effects. Was that Laura King? Do you remember?
Yeah, that's Laura. And what was interesting was that study, you would think having people write what she thought was she'd have people write about the past versus write about the future versus both. And her idea was that having them write about both would be best, because in a way, therapy sometimes works in that way. So let's work through your issues and what are the implications for the future.
Mm-hmm.
She found that writing about both actually wasn't very effective, that having them write about the future was beneficial or just the past was beneficial. And since then, there have been a lot of other studies looking at having people write about just positive effects. And or just negative. And what is generally found is that writing about positive effects is also beneficial for health.
Mm-hmm. Well, what it kind of indicates is that thinking is beneficial for health.
I think that's true. And it's also, you know, the best studies, as I stand back and look at the kind of the broad panorama of research, is giving people instructions to write really loosely, in the sense of, here, you write about the most traumatic experience of your life, but you know, a lot of people haven't had traumas, or maybe you've come to terms with traumas, but write about those topics that are weighing upon you the most right now.
Mm-hmm.
They may be positive, they may be negative, they may be most, or a little bit of both. And essentially, that's what I encourage people to do, is to, if you're having trouble sleeping, you know, set aside 15 minutes and just explore your thoughts and feelings about issues that are weighing on you. Maybe something that you don't want to talk about, or something you don't really want to address.
Yeah. Well, when we set up the future, I'll run you by the latest research on the future authoring program, because you won't know about all of it. But so basically, what we've done with the future authoring program, which is the one with which now we've administered to thousands of university students in different locales with very, very stable results. And the results are quite remarkable, I think. So the way the thing is structured is we first get people to consider six important dimensions of their life. So we're kind of construing the individual as something that's distributed across dimensions, practical dimensions. So those are intimate relationship, friendships, family, career, education, time spent outside of work, and use of drugs and alcohol, because that's a rabbit hole people can really go down. And having at least an idea of how you should handle intoxicating substances is better than just going into it blindly. So the first thing we get people to write about, and loosely following that idea, it's like a free association idea in psychoanalysis, right? It's like, but it also, I think, frees people up to make mistakes, because they get uptight if they have to do it right. You have to say, look, you don't have to do it right. You can do it badly. It's better than not doing it at all. So we have them write about, to envision what they would like if they could have what they wanted on each of those domains. It's like, okay, it's 3 to 5 years down the road. Imagine you're taking care of yourself and as if you were someone you cared about, and that things were set up optimally for you. Hypothetically, what would that look like? And what I found in my clinical practice very frequently is that people are afraid of specifying their future because they're afraid of hope. But also, there's an avoidance element, which is that once you specify your criteria for success, you've also specified your criteria for failure. Mm-hmm. And if you keep things vague and ill-defined, then you can stumble along without ever really noticing that you're lost. And it's a really bad strategy in the medium to long term, but I think it's effective as a means it's effective self-deception in the short term. Anyways, they do that first, and then we get them to write for 15 minutes with no concern for spelling or grammar, which I think we took directly from your research, and just to sketch out what life could be like three years down the road if they had what would be good for them. Mm-hmm. All right, and so now that also gives them something to aim for, eh? And so one of the things that we've been thinking through with regards to having something to aim for is the fact that the systems that utilize dopamine, the incentive reward systems, which basically produce most of the positive emotion that of the kind that people really like, only respond in relationship to a specified goal. So you feel an incentive reward kick when you're moving towards a valued target. So if there's no valued target, there's no positive emotion in life, except in consequence of direct pleasures, say, but there's no ongoing excitement or enthusiasm about tackling hard problems, for example, because there's no evidence that those are related to a valued destination. And, and it's the entire dopaminergic system that responds to that. And that's, of course, the system that cocaine and drugs like that affect. And so then we do something else, which we've introduced more recently, which is we say, okay, now, look, you specified the positive pole, and that gives you something to run towards. Now, we want you to think through the ways the faults that you have, and the resentment and anger that you hold for whatever it is that you're angry about and resentful about and unhappy about, and to consider your bad habits and imagine where those could drag you 3 to 5 years from now if you let them take the upper hand. And so people write about that for 15 minutes, and we think, well, that gives them a negative pole to run away from, like a hell to run away from and a heaven to run towards. And there's some good evidence from the animal literature that animals that are running away and running towards at the same time are run faster, they're more motivated. And then in the second half, they lay out a well-articulated, long-term implementable plan. And we try to get them to deeply articulate it, say, well, you know, break it into 8 goals, rank order the goals. If you attained goal number 1, why would that be good for you? Why would it be good for your family? Why would it be good for broader society? What would you do if obstacles arose? Okay, so that's the pattern. And now, at the University of Rotterdam, at the business school there, so it's the Rotterdam School of Management. I've been working with Michaela Schippers there and her colleagues. We've run about 7,000 people through that now. And the research indicates there's a bunch of interesting things. Overall, it's raised grade point average about 20% and dropped their dropout rate about 25%, which is absolutely phenomenal. It was far larger effects than we would have imagined. But the effects are quite interesting because, you know, with most interventions, you rate, if there's a distribution of performance, you intervene and you raise the higher performing people even higher,
mm-hmm.
you know, absent a ceiling effect.
Right, right.
Better performance. Mm-hmm. But this has the opposite effect. It raises the lower end up. And so mm-hmm. at Rotterdam, the students that were most positively affected were the ones who were performing the worst.
Mm-hmm.
And there, we divided them up by gender and ethnicity. So male, female, obviously. But then we divided them into ethnic Hollanders, so mostly Caucasian natives, and mm-hmm. then non-Western ethnic minorities.
Mm-hmm.
So the males were underperforming the females. And mm-hmm. then it was female Dutch natives, male Dutch natives, female non-Western ethnic minorities, male non-Western ethnic minorities. There was a big gap between the Dutch females and the non-Western ethnic minority men. Within 2 years of completing the program, the non-ethnic Western minority men passed the Dutch women, even though
Very
the Dutch
cool.
women also increased a little bit. Yeah, so, and then we replicated that more recently in Canada at a little college called Mohawk College, and we found there that men were underperforming women again. And then we divided them into how well they were doing in high school before they came into college. And the worst performing males were the ones who were doing poorly in university before they hit college. The males who were in high school and who had the worst grades were those who improved most with the use of the future authoring program. And they did the whole thing in an hour, badly. Mm-hmm. In one session before
that's very
went to college.
That's very impressive. Could you send me a copy of that? I'd love to see that.
No problem. Get,
I can't
send you a copy of the Mohawk paper yet because it hasn't been released, but mm-hmm. I'll send you the rest of them. But yeah,
that's
know,
fabulous
the results
because these are the issues, of course, I'm dealing with right now here at the University of Texas, trying to find out, you know, and most of the interventions that we are looking at is essentially aiming at lower social class kids who are coming to college for the first time, who face so many obstacles that the upper middle class students aren't even aware exist.
Yeah, well, we're trying to think through why this works, you know? And so mm-hmm. part of it is, I think, and I've thought this through a lot, part of it is I think that the schools before college never really require kids to make a decision, and they don't teach them how to make decisions. They never teach them that their life is theirs to master, let's say, and that they have to make a plan, but that the plan has to serve them. And we also have a suspicion that maybe men won't work unless they have their own plan. Maybe that's mm-hmm. associated with trait agreeableness, although we're still investigating that. But there is no doubt that these, at least as far as our research has shown, that these interventions, the future planning interventions, seem to have a more salutary effect on men, but mm-hmm. the men are underperforming, you know, so mm-hmm. so for some reason the women don't have the same problem. But it's something like males won't work unless they have their own reasons to, which mm-hmm. which wouldn't surprise me given that males are more mm-hmm. disagreeable than females, so mm-hmm. it's certainly possible. But you know, the effects on dropout at Mohawk College were walloping, about 50% decrease
mm-hmm.
in the first semester. And of course, uh-huh. that's when kids always drop out.
Mm-hmm.
So there's something about having a plan. So we are thinking too that what's happening is, and this kind of goes back to your comments about both positive and negative emotion, it's mm-hmm. it seems to be something like uncertainty reduction.
Mm-hmm.
And so that reduces the effect of doubt, let's say, mm-hmm. and also tagging, you know, having the person design a future they also want tags success with positive emotion, and that mm-hmm. carries them forward potentially through obstacles.
Mm-hmm.
So, yes.
It'd be very interesting to analyze the essays that these people wrote using our computer program.
Yeah, well, you know, I think we may have done that, if I remember correctly. We may have done that with the Rotterdam study, but I have to look because we've used your LIWC a couple of times to look for the same sort of phenomena. We've also done that to look at whether or not we could extract out big five traits from writing samples, and that's mm-hmm. also possible. So
yeah, I'm less sanguine about the big five approach. because language and self-reports are really, really different animals.
Yeah, well, I'd like to talk to you now, if you would, about your, now you did the computer analysis of words, and that got you interested in different categories of words, correct? And
that's
correct.
You wrote
a whole book on pronouns.
That's right.
Now, part of the reason I want to talk to you about pronouns, apart from the fact that I'm interested in it, is I've been embroiled in a political controversy in Canada for the last 5 months. There's been legislation here formulated at the federal level, it's already in place at the provincial level, mandating the use of what have been called preferred pronouns. And I don't know if that's come to the University of Texas at Austin or not yet, but the idea is that people of non-specific gender, let's say, have the right to choose the pronouns by which other people will address them. And that's actually been mandated in Canadian law, which is something I've been objecting to vociferously, because I don't believe the government should mandate language content. I think it's a massive error. But anyway, so I have a specific interest in pronouns, and I know also that pronouns are in a closed linguistic category, so they don't change that frequently. But you wrote a whole book describing why pronouns were so significant from a psychological perspective.
Right. And it's not just pronouns. It's a whole class of words called function words. And if you look at any text or you listen very carefully, most of what we convey are what we call content words. These are nouns and regular verbs and adjectives, most adverbs. And they're the guts of what we're talking about. But we have all these little words, articles, a, an, and the prepositions, to, of, for, pronouns, he, she, they, it, etc. And in English, there's only about 180 common pronouns. Now, the average person has a vocabulary of 100,000 words, but only, you know, less than one half of 1% of those words are these function words, yet they account for 60% of all the words we use. They control how we talk, and what they are specifying is how we connect with one another, and how we connect with our topic, and how we think about ourselves and our group. And by analyzing these function words, you get a really good sense of who a person is. And that's the underlying theory of the work I've been doing for the last several years, using this computer program, which is Linguistic Inquiry and Word Count, LIWC, which I pronounce Luke. And the Luke program is really just a dumb program that mostly is looking at these function words.
So tell us some things that you've found specific words.
So let's start off with the most commonly used spoken word, which is the word I. I tells us so much about people. And if you go into your email, you're going to see that you use I sometimes in an email you won't. So, for example, people who are depressed use the word I more than when they're not depressed. People who are suicidal use it even more. So one of our first studies was looking at poets who either committed suicide or didn't, and we analyzed their poetry. The suicidal poets did not use more negative emotion words. They didn't make more references to death. They used the word I more. And why? Because pronouns, including I, tell us where we're paying attention. Uh-huh. If you use the word I, you're self-focused. And you know as a clinician that one of the theories of depression is that it's a disease of self-focus, that people are so ruminative and looking inward so much.
Let me ask you a question about that. So that seems related to the psychometric finding that self-consciousness is a facet of neuroticism. Let me ask you one other question along with that. But so, because self-consciousness seems to load with the negative emotions, but also one of the things that I often recommend to my clinical clients who are socially anxious, because I've watched how they interact, and because they get self-focused, they don't look at other people. They don't look at their face, for example, and
that's
they're
right.
Busily thinking about how other people are looking at them. And they're busily thinking about what they're
That's
going
right.
to say next. And so what happens is they stop looking at the face of the people that they're talking to or listening to them. And so then they're extraordinarily awkward. And so what I've done is, instead of telling people to stop thinking about themselves, I've said, when you enter a conversation, really, really focus on the other people. Push your attention outward. And because that seems to activate their unconscious and automatized professional, let's say, socialization.
That's exactly right.
Skills. And then they can flow with the conversation.
That's exactly right. And to build on this, the idea of people who are leaders and status. If you look at the two people, you can tell with remarkable accuracy who's the higher status by the person who uses fewer I's. The high status person doesn't use the word I much. The lower status person doesn't, because the high status person is looking out at the world, and the lower status person, as you're pointing out, is looking inward. Huh. And you could take this to the bank. Go look at your emails, and you'll see when you're writing to someone of higher status, you tend to use I more, and when you're writing to someone of lower status, you use I less.
Let me tell you another observation that I've had. You tell me what you think about this. I'm going to tell you about an observation from animation first. So I've done some very in-depth analysis of various Disney movies, including The Lion King, and The Lion King involves a child and then an adolescent lion who matures. And so, and the animators also represented his father. Now, his father has a very interesting face because it looks like this. Like, it's focused forward and kind of staring. Almost, you might think of almost predatory, because a predatory gaze is locked on someone else. But, and then the adolescent lion, who's kind of naive and imbecilic in some sense, is like this all the time. And so it seems to me that there's a relationship between immaturity and self-focus and maturity and outward focus. And in The Lion King, when the adolescent lion undergoes this initiation rite, his face changes into one like this, into one of determination. And the other thing that seems related to this is that, you know, when people are speaking in front of a group, they often get self-conscious, and they feel all the eyes on them, and that makes them self-conscious. And one of the things that I've recommended to people who want to speak to groups is never to speak to the group, just to look at one individual, and then another individual, and then another individual, because that, well, that seems to foster communication, but it also blows out the probability of becoming self-conscious. So
that's exactly right. In fact, I have recommended to teacher trainers. So here's what you do at my university for teacher training. You give a practice lecture, and you have the camera is in the audience looking at you. That's the wrong way to do it. The way that you should train teachers is put a camera behind the teacher at the audience and point out afterwards, look, they're not, that guy's not paying attention to you. That person is. And in other words, not making you self-focused, making you that if you're training a teacher, training a public speaker, doing exactly what you're saying, you should give them the view of what the audience looks like and not what you look like.
Right.
That's the exact wrong training.
Absolutely. You know, so tell me what you think about this. When I'm lecturing, I pay attention to the people who are paying attention. Mm-hmm. Now, I mean, most of the time, most people in my lectures are paying attention, at least a reasonable proportion of them. But the ones that aren't, well, I don't know why they're not. But there's lots of reasons. They might have had a bad night. They might be overtired. They may have taken the course by mistake. I mean, God only knows. But if I'm paying attention to the students that are paying attention, then I can read off their faces how the audience is thinking, especially if I glance around. But it's that intense communication from individual to individual that seems to make a lecture or an interview or a conversation really compelling.
That's exactly right. I think that's the secret to, one of the secrets to being a good teacher and a good speaker is really being able to watch and also to judge when all of a sudden you're starting to lose them.
Yeah,
and,
right.
You know, you're also doing little experiments the whole time. You know, one of the things that people who are relatively new is they start to lose people, and then they start speaking more quickly, which of course is precisely the wrong thing to do.
Yeah. And they start paying less attention because they get self-conscious and want to hide from the audience, and then they get into a loop.
Yeah.
And things just go, you know, the worst speakers I've ever seen stand at the front of the audience with their head down and mumble at their feet. It's just painful. I mean, okay, so that's very interesting. So, okay, so you talked about I and you talked about dominance. What else have you learned about specific words?
Well, a couple more things about I mixed with some others. One is honesty. So the ability to detect deception versus honesty as a function of how people talk. And what we find is that we've done many studies where we induce people to lie and tell the truth, and then we look at the transcripts of the two. And what we find is when people tell the truth, they tend to use I more. They're owning what they're saying. And the person who is lying is psychologically distancing themselves from what they're saying. And then there's another feature is when you're telling the truth, you tend to use more words that are, we used to call them exclusive words or differentiation words, where you use words like except, but, without, exclude. Words where you're making a distinction between what's in a category and not in a category. That these exclusive kind of words are, you're being more honest because you're saying what you did, but also what you didn't do. And that's a really complex cognitive task. Whereas if you're lying and you didn't do any of it, to say what you didn't not do is just beyond the capabilities of most people. So both I word usage and these exclusive words together do a pretty good job. And another one is also focusing on details.
Can you do that with political speeches?
Oh yeah, and there's been some nice research on that as well. Jeff Hancock, for example, who's now at Stanford, has played with this idea quite a bit when he was looking at all of the rhetoric about weapons of mass destruction during the Bush administration. What he found was administrators were using deceptive language prior to our going to war.
So that opens it up a whole completely appalling and interesting scenario. It's like, I mean, increasingly people are using computer programs to analyze personality and that sort of thing by analyzing people's behavior on the web.
That's exactly right. And we've been doing this a lot with political figures. And in fact, one of my graduate students and I, Kayla Jordan, we have a website that's called Word Watchers. It's wordwatchers.wordpress.com. And by going there, you can see our analysis of Trump and actually this whole election. From my perspective as a scientist, this has been a phenomenal electoral season. As a human being, not so much.
I'm gonna get you when we're done here. I'll email you, and you can give me some links, okay, that I can put in the description here where people can go look this sort of thing up.
You bet.
So that's interesting. So can you actually rank order politicians in terms of the probability that they're telling the truth?
Yes, I could, but I'm not sure I'd trust it very much. Because one of the interesting issues about deception is you've got some people who are deceptive, but they honestly believe they're telling the truth. And I think I think Trump actually falls into that category. I think he actually believes what he says, and he might say just the opposite 10 minutes later, and he'll believe that as well.
Yeah, so do you suppose that, okay, so that's interesting, because I've seen in poorly written undergraduate essays, you commonly see, I think about it as fracturing at different levels of the linguistic hierarchy. So, you know, if you listen to a schizophrenic speak, they're actually fractured at the level of the phrase.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you listen to a manic speak, they're more like fractured at the level of the sentence or the paragraph. They can say a whole paragraph, and then in the next paragraph, they'll say something completely different. That contradicts the first paragraph, but there's no awareness of the contradiction. And in poorly written undergraduate essays, there'll be a claim made on page one, and then a claim made on page two that are completely antithetical. And, you know, it isn't self-evident that you become conscious of paradoxes in your thinking unless you act out both propositions simultaneously and it produces a conflict. Because you can hold paradoxical information without ever knowing it. And so maybe what happens with someone who does that sort of contradictory speech is that temperamentally they're very confident. So they might be assertive, for example.
That's
right. Agreeable to something like that. And maybe also low in or high in stress tolerance. So they're not anxious people. They're assertive and they don't really care so much what other people think. So they come across continually as confident. And so that would be more like temperamental confidence, which is a form. It's a funny thing because it's not exactly the same as telling the truth, but it is something more like believing what you say or believing in what you say.
That's right. And what I think that the text analytic approach is better at is when a person knows damn well they're telling a lie.
Right.
And that's when our tells do better. There's another phenomenon. It's called a performative. It's one of my favorites that you hear. And that is performatives are used in linguistics, and they're usually a phrase, and they might be something like, let me assure you, or as I've said before, or believe me when I say. And if you have a performative, it makes the entire sentence you're not able to detect if it's true or not. So you can't establish the truth value. Let me assure you that this is a glass of water. Now, is that true or not? Well, it's yes, actually it is, because I want to assure you it's a glass of water. It's true because I want to assure you that it is, even though it's not.
Right.
And what happens is, consciously, we don't know we do this, but it's almost so our brain is kind of trying to protect us, and we throw these up. And I have another webpage that has a number of performatives that you see in president after president, where the president says something that at the beginning sets it up so it's a performative, and then the second half, sure enough, it is a lie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, so do you suppose that, okay, that's interesting. So do you suppose that, so is the performative a marker for deceit?
I think it is.
Something deceptive is coming?
Yes, I think it is. In fact, Trump's great, his best one is, believe me. So,
right.
I know more about the army than the generals. Believe me.
Right, right. Do you suppose he's trying to convince himself?
He is, and it's a form of performative, which is he's really saying, "Please believe me that I know more." Da 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 da.
Right.
He doesn't phrase it that way, but that's what it essentially is. So it's
right. Well, it kind of makes you wonder if he thinks that if people believe him, that makes it true.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, because it's a funny thing, because there is some truth to the idea that true things are what other people believe.
Mm-hmm.
Now, obviously, you don't want to go too far down that road.
That's right.
But there is something, I mean, because, for example, a contract holds no truth unless there's consensus around it.
Mm-hmm.
So whenever the reality is dependent on everyone agreeing to do the same thing, then consensus is actually a very good marker for truth.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because there's lots of situations where you say, well, if we agree on all this, then it's going to be true. That's what a contract is.
Mm-hmm.
So it's almost as if using words like that is an attempt to establish a contract where no contract can genuinely be established. I mean, we can't
That's right.
a contract about whether or not Iran has weapons of mass destruction, but we can certainly have a contract about whether or not we'll go to war over it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Cool. So what else has he got with regards to interesting words? Because that was really fascinating.
Well, there's a whole we could go for hours on this, actually. So another one that I've been quite interested in is using these groups of words and looking at how two people connect in terms of these function words. So what we could do is we could actually calculate the percentage agreement we have in our use of pronouns, prepositions, articles, conjunctions, and so forth. And we call this language style matching. And the closer two people are in their use of these words in a given conversation, the more they are in tune with one another.
Wow, and so that's being on the same wavelength.
That's exactly right. And it's not necessarily liking one another. It's being absolutely paying attention to one another. So two people in the midst of an argument tend to entrain really closely, just like two people madly in love. Now, we've done analyses of transcripts of speed dates. And what we find is we actually can predict who will go on a subsequent date at rates somewhat higher than the people themselves.
So what's happening is the rapid establishment of mutual imitation.
That's exactly
right.
That's
exactly what happens from the Piagetian perspective when two children start to play.
That's exactly right.
Cool.
And we've looked at one that I particularly liked was we looked at 86 dating couples. These were freshmen in college, and freshmen in college are in notoriously unstable relationships, which from my perspective is perfect for research. And to be in our studies, they had to do instant messaging at least daily with each other and to give us 10 days of their IMs, which they did. And what we did, and we also asked them, how good is your relationship? How likely will you be together in several months? And what we found was that we did a shockingly good job at predicting who'd still be together. Those people who were, if we just averaged, got their style matching score, their average entrainment score, and we just got the top half, 80% were still together 3 months later. If they were in the bottom half, only 50% were still together.
Wow. So that's cool.
And people's self-reports about their relationship was absolutely unrelated to whether or not they were still together.
So that's like dancing.
Mm-hmm. It is. Right. I've always thought of this as a dance. That's exactly
so cool.
Right.
Yeah. Because so what that really means in some sense is that, think about it this way, is that the two people come together, and the two of them, it's as if they're making something, they make something jointly that they're both acting out. Mm-hmm. So that they're uniting into something central.
That's right.
And then you might think, too, that in order for that to happen, they have to be paying close attention to each other.
That's right.
Right? And so you can't entrain with someone unless you pay close attention to them. And
that's
certainly
right.
One of the best markers for the utility of a relationship is going to be whether or not the people pay attention to each other, right?
That's exactly right.
That's why children are so absolutely desperate for adult attention. That's mm-hmm. their currency.
Yes, that's exactly right. Yeah.
Right. Wow, that's really cool. Well, have you got another one?
I've got another one. Three or four years ago, I started working with much bigger data sets. So this was with about 25,000 college students who have been admitted to my university over 4 years. And I got their admissions essays, and these essays are people explaining why they want to come to the university, you know, how they have overcome a difficult time or something like that. So each person wrote two essays, and we went through and started to do some kind of a general analysis of word use, focusing on these function words, and found that there was a central dimension to language. This is a fundamental dimension, and it's what I'm calling it is analytic versus narrative thinking. Huh. The people high on analytic thinking are using high rates of articles and prepositions. At the other end of this dimension are people who are using high rates of pronouns, auxiliary verbs, conjunctions, negations, and so forth. It is a coherent dimension, and that any text can be put along this continuum. And in fact, it's like a fingerprint. People who, you know, use words at this level tend to do so in other, if it's emails, other emails or natural conversation, etc.
So are the narrative people using more metaphors?
Yeah, they probably would.
Tell me how you would tell the difference if you were reading.
Well, before we get into metaphors, metaphors are going to take us down a rabbit hole. So let's before we fall down the hole, let me just point out, this analytic thinking, what's so cool about it is we were able to track these students' grades over the next 4 years of college. And the higher they were on analytic thinking, the better they did in college. And in terms of grades, it was correlated about 0.2. And it did matter if they were physics majors or fine art majors, if they were in engineering, psychology, music, social work, that this, you could take this to the bank. The more analytic a person is in their essay, the better they do in college. And part of it is college is based on analytic thinking.
Right.
But it's also correlated with intelligence. It's correlated with SAT.
At what level?
Probably about 0.3, 0.35.
Oh, yeah, that's pretty good. That's pretty high.
Yeah, it's really quite striking. And what's interesting is that we can now use this as kind of a remote sensor to get a sense of how smart somebody is. So if we're analyzing...
Man, you're a dangerous man.
I'm a dangerous man.
That, very that's dangerous. For sure.
Yeah, yeah. So that's another one. And we've been playing with many other things. We've been doing a lot of work on author identification. So... Uh-huh. We published a cool article, one of my graduate students, Ryan Boyd, and I have been focusing on a lost play, or a play that was attributed to Shakespeare, but people didn't know if it was or not. And we were able to do some really smart analyses showing pretty clearly that it was written by Shakespeare, probably co-authored with another guy, John Fletcher.
Wow.
And we've looked at some other manuscripts that have been called into question that have come out of the 17th century. So we know we've been taking this work in all of these different directions.
Cool. Okay, so let's close this off by, why don't you tell us something about what you're doing with regards to revamping undergraduate education at the University of Texas, and what your aims are, and also why it was that you were picked or chose to do this.
Exactly. It all gets into my analysis of language. I was doing all of this work trying to understand, could I get a group of initially two people, but then as many as five people to interact with one another on the computer? And if so, could I track how they are interacting with each other and get a sense of how the group was working? And working with some computer scientists, we were able to come up with a really slick program to do that. And then it occurred to me, wouldn't it be interesting to do that in a large class? Because I taught a large introductory psychology class with a colleague of mine, Sam Gosling. And we had 500 students in the class. We had them bring a laptop to school class one day. And we were able to break the class into small groups of five each. They could interact with each other. And we were able to track how they were interacting. And we could give feedback to the group, trying to get the group to work better. So we, using the style matching, we could tell people whether or not members of the group were paying attention to each other, or if someone was talking too much, we could ask them to not talk so much and so forth. And it worked. The next semester, we realized, you know, we could use this idea and revamp the class from top to bottom, where we got rid of the textbook, so all readings were online. We'd have a quiz at the beginning of every class. We would have break the class into interactions more frequently. In other words, started to rethink the class from top to bottom, and then we moved it into an online class so that we were able to broadcast out, and we switched the format of the class. It was like a TV show. So we were behind a desk, we'd have fake news, we'd have, or at least one of us would be in front of a green screen or somewhere in some other place.
I don't know if you use the word fake news. I'm not sure that's appropriate.
No. It used to be, people used to know what I meant, but I now, as soon as I said that, I realized I can't use that anymore.
Yeah.
But this idea of one of us would be on in front of a scene somewhere on Earth, you know, so one of us... You know, I would say, Sam, where are you? It looks like you are in a balloon today. And you know, so it looks like he's in a balloon and so forth. In any case, the point was we turned this into a television show. And what we found was that by broadcasting this out to 1,500 students, we set it up because there was testing every day, that students were in class every day. They were focusing more on the material. They were more engaged, and it turns out that their average performance went up compared to when we taught it in the past. And more impressively, people who took our online class did better in the other classes they were taking that semester.
Oh yeah, that's impressive.
And the classes they took the semester afterwards.
What kind of improvement did you get?
It wasn't huge. It was like the difference between a 3.1 versus a 3.25. And we reduced the disparity between upper middle and lower middle class students in terms of their performance, so that historically we found a one letter grade between the upper middle and lower middle class students.
Yeah.
And now we had reduced it to 0.4 letter grade.
Okay, that's big. That's big. So that's kind of analogous to what was happening with the future authoring program.
That's right.
How do you account for that? You think it had that differential effect on the lower performing students?
It turns out we came across some previous research that had found similar effects, but it deals with frequent testing. The idea is kids who come from lower middle class backgrounds, by and large, went to crappy high schools. And in these high schools, our kids are all smart. They're always, most of them are in the top 7% of their high school class. But if they were at a crappy high school, they learned to get by memorizing. Because
right.
Their tests were memorization tests. And so these kids were great at memorizing. And then they come to a real university where you're not tested on memorization. You have to think conceptually.
Right, right.
And historically, when we taught those the classes, we had this usual 3 or 4 tests over the course of the semester. I would always get students in my office walking in after the first test saying, I have never made a B in my life, and I just failed your first test. That's impossible. How is this even possible? And I would say, how did you study? Well, I had flashcards. I did this. I memorized this.
I said,
I told you memorization doesn't work. You have to think conceptually. And that doesn't mean anything to these kids. But now you've got a test every day, and you fail that first test, pow. You fail the second test, pow. And all of a sudden, you're realizing, wow, it's true. Memorizing doesn't work.
So you think what's happening is that they're learning that memorization doesn't work faster.
That's exactly right.
That's really funny.
And they use these skills in their other classes because they realize memorization's not working in the other classes either.
So how do they catch on to the so now they know that memorization doesn't work. How do they figure out what does work?
Well, it's been interesting moving to the online world. We create all of these videos, which basically there's a video on how to study, and there's another video on how to take a test, and another video on how do you manage your time. In other words, now we understand the problem a lot better than we did before, and so students are taking advantage of these resources and end up doing better.
That's cool. So how long have you been doing that?
We started the class the first year in 2011. And then in the years afterwards, I started talking to people at the University of Texas and elsewhere about kind of the big picture of education, which was, what the hell are we doing in education right now? The world has changed.
That I've been asking myself.
I know, but the world's changed. Why do we have 3-hour courses? There's no logic for a 3-hour course. Why do we have a semester that goes from the 1st of January to sometime in May? There's no reason for that. Why do we have a half-hour course? Why do we have a 7-hour course? In other words, why do we put things together the way we do? And it turns out there's really good reasons, because in the early 1900s, we needed a standardized way of talking about credit and so forth. And then we built computers to program this in, and we built buildings that we knew how to use time and space and location, and so that your computer will tell you this class is going to meet in this room at this time, and your final exam will be at this place and this place. We don't need all of that.
Yeah, well, it's analogous to the conservation of physical structure and evolution.
That's exactly right. And what's interesting is the University of Texas computer that the registrar uses can't make a half-hour course.
Right.
It can't change the semester. It can't do any of these things. And a modern student information system computer costs an unbelievable amount of money. And so what I'm doing is I am working with the university and the entire infrastructure to start to rethink everything. What should be the curriculum? We don't need all these required courses that we used to have. It makes no sense. A lot of our requirements made a lot of sense 50 years ago, and a lot of our classes were flunk-out classes. We don't need flunk-out classes anymore. And we can come up with really brief classes, half-hour classes, to learn a basic skill. For example, we have a requirement you have to have a statistics course to take upper division psychology classes. Do you really need the statistics course? Well, most of it you don't. And if I ask the people teaching statistics, asking them, do the statistics you're teaching, are they relevant to today? And they all say, oh, not at all. I mean, I don't use analysis of variance. I don't use t-tests. I use linear regression. I use this. I use that. But we can't teach that. And my view is, if you're going to take my upper division class, you better know correlations. And you better know correlations up and down. I could teach a correlation course that would be a 0.7-hour course. And download it and take it anytime. Yeah. I don't care when you take it.
Yeah, well, I've been using YouTube a lot for the last 3 years, you know. And
that's right.
I started putting my lectures online just mm-hmm. taped with an iPad, you know. And by the beginning of 2016, I'd collected about 1 million views. And I mm-hmm. thought, oh, that's a whole different thing than I thought it was. I thought YouTube was for cute cat videos. And then I started thinking it through and I thought, oh no, look, here's the situation, man. For the first time in human history, the spoken word has as much staying power and reach as books. No, more reach. Mm-hmm. You can publish faster and it can mm-hmm. be broken up and communicated in all sorts of chunks. It's like, this is absolutely revolutionary. It seems to me that, universities are in a race against time.
That's exactly right, because this is the new world order, and it's like every other part of our world right now, where we're dealing with the future of AI and the future of everything, that this really messes with the world order, because so much of what we can teach can be put up there, and because correlations haven't changed a hell of a lot in the last 100 years. Yep. You don't need to update your lecture on correlations.
Right, and there's need one really good lecture on correlations, not 1,000 of them or 10,000 of them. That's also very frightening.
That's exactly right. But then we do need, we're talking now 15th century. We do need a guild mentality. If you're going to become a therapist, a scientist, or this or that, you need to have some serious lab experience. You need to have some serious experience doing things in addition to learning how to think and to get some smart feedback on how to think, how to come up to, get up to the level to understand what's involved in trying to make new science, to make new advances. It's an incredibly exciting time. And I'm working with all parts of the university. I have 200 people working with me. I've got various, we're dealing with a development studio, working on new ways of thinking of online and other technologies. I've got a big research and methods group trying to find out what even works. We don't even know what works and what doesn't. We're having to deal with extended campus in terms of how we can push out our classes, our information to the world in a way that has some kind of financial value to the university. So we, and this office that
you
I'm
guys,
doing.
Have you guys been thinking about accreditation? Because it seems mm-hmm. to me that the thing is that the ability to disseminate valuable information was once, the university in some sense had a hammer lock on that. That's gone.
That's right.
No more
That's
hammer
right.
lock.
That's right.
But the thing that the impediment to mass education at the moment, in some sense, is the problem of mass accreditation.
That's
and
right.
universities still have a hammer lock on that, but there's no reason that they need to. So mm-hmm. I'm curious, when you're thinking about the mass distribution of educational material, what have you been thinking about in relation to accreditation?
The problems and the complexity of this are unbelievable. So some of it is the nationwide bureaucracy. So there are accrediting agencies that don't know how to deal with fractional credit, don't know how to deal with a variable calendar. We've got mm-hmm. financial aid issues because they're based on these old systems as well.
Right.
We're dealing with intellectual property in terms of who owns the IP of a class. Is it the instructor? Is it the university? Can the university resell it? How do we rethink this? The idea of having free open classes is great, but it's not a very good business model. And this has been one of the problems with Coursera and edX, and you're putting your videos on online for free because
I've been using Patreon, you know. You know about Patreon?
No, I don't.
Oh, it's really interesting. It's a platform that was developed because of the difficulties that creative people were having in monetizing their production.
Mm-hmm.
And so with Patreon, people can voluntarily buy a monthly subscription.
Uh-huh.
If they find that the content that you're producing is worth supporting,
mm-hmm.
then they can donate monthly to your Patreon account.
Mm-hmm.
And they can either do that on a monthly basis or they can pay you a donation per video that you put up.
Uh-huh.
And that's been a very, you know, I thought with my YouTube content, because I wanted to professionalize what I was doing to some degree, to hire a film crew and to improve the audio and all of that. And I threw up a Patreon account online last April when I found out about the technology, just mm-hmm. out of curiosity. And I got about, I don't know, 60 or 70 people subscribing in the first month. So that was kind of interesting. And, mm-hmm. And it's enabled me to hire a film crew and that sort of thing. But it's quite interesting because the Patreon people, although there's some perks they get, like I send the higher donors a signed copy of one of my books, for example, but mostly they don't get access to any content that everyone doesn't get access to. But people have a strong sense of reciprocity,
mm-hmm.
and they're not completely comfortable with the idea of getting something for nothing. And mm-hmm. that the Patreon account has been extraordinarily useful to me. It's
very
it's,
interesting.
Yeah. Well, it yeah, is, and, it's and these are and these, what we're doing now, for example.
And, you know, and these are issues that we're struggling with at the university in terms of how do we do it, because to do one of our courses is really quite expensive, and $10,000, $20,000, $30,000, and trying to figure out the model for it. The one thing that we can do is we can give university credit. So that's one hold that we have, but it really does deal with a broader issue in our society, which is. Is knowing the material and knowing how to think sufficient to get by in the real world, or do you need the official credential? And
right.
And
yeah, well, you need both.
Yes, or if it was a just world, just knowing the material would be sufficient.
Yeah, well, the problem is it gives you no rapid way of telling the charlatans from the real thing.
That's the big issue. And that's the big issue.
And then another problem is that as the credential becomes more important, the knowledge becomes less important because you can use the credential to play the system.
That's right. That's exactly right. So these are the kinds of things that I've been dealing with. And I'm trying to change a giant bureaucracy turns out not real easy.
Yeah. You said why. It has all these built-in assumptions that are part of the structure, not only part of the cognitive apparatus, but actually built right into the infrastructure.
That's exactly right. And what I've found is the people at the university have been very supportive. I thought for sure I would run into major obstacles.
Yep.
Faculty, students, administrators, even the legislators, because this is a public university, are all really supportive.
Yep.
And even though I've got support all around, it's still just like swimming through molasses.
Yep.
Because there are all of these rules and regulations that have been there sometimes for 100 years that no longer serve a purpose.
Well, maybe you don't know, but the typical Fortune 500 company only lasts 30 years.
Mm-hmm.
And the typical family fortune, 3 generations.
Mm-hmm.
And it's for the reasons that you just described, is what happens is that the structure itself becomes so anachronistic that not even the people within it can change it.
Yeah.
And so that something comes along that's younger and that's built on different presuppositions, it just takes it out. And the probability that that's going to happen to the universities, in my opinion, is overwhelmingly high,
mm-hmm.
because of exactly the sorts of things that you described. It's structural. It's built for a different century.
Yes,
in fact,
it might
be built for the late 1800s.
Well, it is, and actually, if you think about it, university started in the 1400s, And it's amazing that they have survived as well as they have.
Yeah, that's for sure. That's for sure. Well, look, it was really good talking to you.
I've enjoyed this myself.
I've been a great admirer of your research, and I don't say that lightly, because
thank you.
There's a handful of psychologists that have had a profound effect on me, and you're certainly one of them. And I would also say you're a spectacular rarity among social psychologists, in my estimation. So I know that's a nasty thing to say, but being partly a social psychologist, I guess I'm allowed to say it.
Yeah,
so
you can.
I would also like to talk to you again at some point in the future, maybe, 6 months down the road or something, because you have all sorts of things that people need to know about, and this is a really good way of telling people about them. So I'll email you and get some, if you can think of 3 or 4 links and a little description that you'd like to go along with them, I'll put them in the description of the video, and
okay.
I'll tell you when both the podcast and the video will be up, but that'll be very soon.
Okay, sounds good. Send me an email and I will do that.
All right. Very nice talking with you.
Nice talking with you as well. Thanks so much.
All right. Bye-bye.